Good to be here, and thank you for the beginning, your reflections. It's actually you who decided the title of of the lecture, Unlearning of Architecture, and that is totally nonsense, because there isn't any word saying unlearning at all. But I think that what it is about is that last time I was, when I met you last time, I was saying that there was a lot of things that I've learned in architecture school, and when I came out from architecture school, both being practiced and also being working now in the public sector, I can't use that much of what I've been learning, because I see that the world is totally different from what I've learned at the architecture school. So in a way, I think that what I'm doing right now is that I'm unlearning what I did learn before. But still, I try to pick out some cases and some stories which is also about something about learning and unlearning, because I think that what I've learned at architecture school was a way of planning and seeing architecture and the world as a more ideal, a modernistic way of looking at the world. I'm trained, or we are trained, to think that if we just make the plan, then everything would be good. The modernistic way of looking at the city was this, having the idea of the ideal city, and if we just could make it ideal, then everything would be good and everybody would be happy. And I think that right now there is a shift in the way that we look at architecture, in the way that we look at the world, in the way that we look of families, of actually in a way that we look of everything. But we are going from thinking that we can design or make a family ideal, and now we understand that the world is too complex and everything is changing the whole time, so there isn't anything that is in a way right or wrong in that sense. And I think that means that looking at architecture and planning, look at it as a more pragmatic way today. And I think that is what my different stories would be about. And now I just have to pick it up here. Yeah, wow. So, anybody that has not been in Copenhagen? Wow, I think that you might make a study trip to Copenhagen. I would love to invite all of you and show you around and have good discussion about how we can make Copenhagen as well better. So please come. Copenhagen is, as a lot of other big cities in Europe and in the world in general, it's a growing city. We are the same size as Bradford, and we say that we have 1,000 new inhabitants every month. It means that we will be 100,000 more in 2025, which is quite a lot compared to the size of Copenhagen. 2/3 of the people coming to Copenhagen is people from the outside, and 1/3 is babies. And what is Copenhagen about? If we talk to people, if we talk to the tourists that has been there, they say that they talk a lot about the bikes that are all around the city. They talk a lot about people being happy, people smiling. They talk a lot about that there is a lot of water, and they talk a lot about scale, that there is some kind of human scale and there is some kind of coziness. This is our mayor. We have 7 mayors in Copenhagen. This one is my mayor. She's the technical and environmental mayor, Alba Baykal. She's standing here with pride because we are going to be the Europe's Green Capital in 2014. And the theme for that is sharing Copenhagen. So it might be in that occasion that you're coming to Copenhagen. So this is Copenhagen. Just find out where to point. Yeah. This is Copenhagen. This is the fortification ring. The old fortification ring is quite a unique thing. I'm working here. This is one of the bridges. The town hall is here. I'm living here. It's just to give you a sense of the city. I live in the city. I have 2 kids. We are living in the city in our apartment just beside the main station. We do not have a car, and I do not even have a driving license. And I think there's a lot of people in Copenhagen having the same situation as me. We are people that is going around on the bicycles. And that is a lot about what Copenhagen is about, that we have to be experience the city in slow motion. I just go because 20 years ago, the economy in Copenhagen was totally broke. We were put under administration and everything was very bad. I remember being at the architecture school and we were so... we were not proud because there has never ever been a foreign architect been designing anything in Copenhagen. So the architecture wasn't anything special. It was quite a boring city at that time. But then we started to sell some of the land and the economy started to grow. And I will show you three of the first new development in the city. And it's just because we have learned something, and it's about this learning and unlearning. Because we learned something about developing these areas that we are trying to implement in our plans today. This is the first area that we developed. This is 25 years ago, something like that. 30, I can see. This is an old part of the city. The Copenhagen harbor is like a lot of other harbors, old industrial harbor. The industry grew up, moved out of the city, and now we are changing it into a multifunctional part of the city with both housing, offices, and a lot of retail, and a lot of public buildings as well. This is the old church in the middle, and this is a very old Burmester Wayne industry that was there. Today this has changed. You can see that we threw down everything. There was only the church in the middle. It is offices here, it is housing in here. There is a little public space in between. The problem with this is that this is a closed, it's a dead end, so nobody is actually walking around in the city. So it is actually a dead part of the city. We learned a lot from that because it's stupid to make dead ends if we want to have city life. Now we are building a bridge here, which is designed by Olaf Eliasson, and I think that will change that part of the city totally, because then it will start to be a part of the promenade in the city. It's just to say that even if you made some mistakes, you can always make some unlearning or learning and change it into something better. This is another part of the city. There is a lot of old buildings. You can see in this new development, there is a lot more of the old buildings. So we learned that as well. It's stupid to throw down everything because, of course, we have to build on the history. We have to make special characters. We have to tell stories. That is a part of developing the city. This is Islands Brygge, and it's very close to where I'm having my office. This is only 20 years ago, and today it is changed into also multifunctional area with both housing and offices. And this is the same area down to eye level. And it's just because I want to get you down to 160 meters so that we can discuss the city in the level that we experience it. That was the first thing, down to eye level. The next thing I just want to introduce is the way that we try to look at planning in Copenhagen. There is a lot of, we are working very strategically. We have a lot of strategies, a lot of people, a lot of the politicians and the directors think that we have a way too many strategies, and we might have. But it's very important to work on this level. Our politicians is very good because they are the one that is putting out the vision in our strategies. They are the one that decide the politics and the strategies, and we as the public servants has to get their vision down on a very concrete level. It means often we do not discuss architecture, how it looks with our politicians. We try to discuss architecture on what it does to us as human beings and how it will be a part of the strategies that they have decided. So we try to put the values from all the strategies into the local plans And then that is the discussion. That is what we are discussing when we are discussing the local plans. And then, of course, and it's all the small dots, it's very important both to have the down bottom, which is the strategies, the political level, but it's also very important to have a lot of bottom-up projects, a lot of things that is just happening. And we, as the municipality, has to be, in a way, trying to see if we can service all these projects coming from the people and the citizens. So it's very important to get to the man on the floor, and it's very important to have the big visions from our politicians. And we have to try to see if we can connect those three by the three different levels in the scaling. And I think I have four strategies I want to talk about. Three stories about focused urban development, the middle scaling, and then six short stories in the end. Is there anyone who would tell me when I have 5 minutes left? Good. The first strategy I want to talk about is a strategy for how we can create better urban life in the city. I think this is one of the most important strategies we are having. It is decided by our politicians in 2009, and the approach is that we try, when we discuss urban planning in Copenhagen, we try to start discussing urban life before urban space, and discuss urban space before building. And it sounds so simple, and this is exactly the opposite of what I'm trained at school, and probably like a lot of you is trained as well, because normally we start with the buildings, and then we realize that there is some kind of urban space between the buildings, and often we do not ever discuss what kind of urban life we actually want in the urban space. We have a lot of urban space in Copenhagen where you can see that nobody has ever discussed what kind of city life we would like to have in those areas. So it sounds simple, it's totally complicated in reality. There is three goals in this strategy. The first one is that we want more urban life for everybody. The second one is we want people to walk more, and the third one is that we want people to stay longer. So every year we go in, make this urban life account to see if we are reaching the goals that our politicians have put in for us. So we go out, we collect a lot of data, we go out, we have a lot of interviewing with the citizen, we have people counting how many people is walking, how long time they're sitting there. So there is a lot of manuals for how we can actually see if we can be more accountable in the way that we discuss this urban life. We got a lot of numbers, and that is very interesting because we can compare year by year, but we also get a lot of statement from the people in Copenhagen. In 2010, there was, in general, there was this need for more quiet spaces, and there was a need for more landscaping in the city. That is so important for us that, to see if we actually can get that learning into the project that we are working with the next day. In 2011, we had a special focus on a lot of play areas because our politicians had put in a lot of money in on the playgrounds in the city, so we had a special focus on that. And what we could see was that if we actually got specific designed play areas with focusing on movement in new ways, we could see that the adults and the kids were playing together. When they were playing together, we could see that they were staying in urban space longer. And that is fantastic, because that is what our politicians have said to us, that you have to go out, be aware of that people should stay in urban life longer. So that was very interesting that we can actually in that way go and try to see if we can make some more site-specific play areas with having and focusing on movement in a new way. This is one of our projects from the new promenade at the waterside. It's just four trampolines. It's very simple. We are not going to have trampoline all over the world, all over Copenhagen, but it's really interesting to see that everybody, even if you are 80 or anything like that, you start to jump in those trampolines. And because it is on a promenade, so it's a transit space, people just go and then they Sometimes they go back and do it one more time, but it will start to be a way of them moving in the city. It's just to say that it's so easy having this knowledge about people's movement that you can actually put it into your project the day after. Talking about landscape, of course we're not going to put temporary trees all over the city, but it's interesting that it's so easy just to put some more landscape in the city the day after you have this kind of knowledge. And it's so easy to try to work with quiet spaces in a new way when you have this knowledge that people actually want quiet spaces. You can just put up some chairs and then ask people to put them around, to put them the way they want themselves. There is 200 people behind those people. I think they have a quiet space here looking at the waterside. So instead of putting all the benches against each other so we can see each other, it's sometimes very good just to put it back to back, so that we can create our own spaces. It's just to say that by making this urban life account, having this very precise strategy, it's very easy to get some learning so quickly that we could actually do it tomorrow when we're designing the other projects. Then there is a story about our bike strategy. There is four focus in this strategy: city life, comfort, speed, and security. When we asked the Copenhageners why do they be on the bike? I hope that it was because they were sustainable, but it is not. It's because it's the fastest way to go from A to B. So that knowledge about the reason for people to bike is very important when we actually go to design the city, because then we have to make it easy to go, and we have to make it easier to go from A to B by bike or on foot instead of by the car. So in a way, that is a new paradigm also for trying to design the infrastructure in a new way. How many is going on bike here today? Working? Yeah? Someone? Yeah? In Copenhagen, we say that 55% of people living in the city, and I know you're not living in Bradford, every one of you, but 55% of the people living in the city is taking the bike every day to school or to work. So it is really important that it is functioning very well. So there is this focus when we're talking about speed, that instead of making the green waves for the cars, we're now making the green waves for the bicycles. We make a lot of connections. So this bridge was built in 2006. We thought that there would be 3,000 people passing every day on the bike. Today, 5 years later, it is already 10,000 people. And it's because it is a shortcut in the city, and that's why so many people is actually taking it. So now I'm living at the main station, I have 5 minutes on my bike, and then I am in wild nature at Amager. That is fantastic that you can have such, not such a big city, but still a capital, and you can be in wild nature from main station within 5 minutes because you have been making a shortcut for you on the bike. But it also means that the politicians have to be aware of where to put the money in the budget, because they also have to put money in the maintenance of the city. And if we don't have to, if we don't get rid of the snow on the bike lanes before 8 o'clock in the morning, the 55% taking the bicycle in winter time cannot get to work or they cannot get to school. So there is some kind of coherence about the maintenance budget and the building budget. Comfort is also a way of working with putting a special focus on the bicycle. I will say just by tipping the bin is not, doesn't mean that you actually hit the bin. I can tell you about it. In a way, it's a good way to signal that we think good bike, the people biking, we actually want to tell them that we think that you're doing very well and we would like to make it easy for you. And the best thing about being on a bike is that you have so easy by stopping on the bike and walk, because you are in a slow motion. So you can talk to each other, you can experience the city, you can walk more, as the urban life strategy is saying. And it just, I think that is a part of having this good identity in the city. The other day I got some new red shoes. And I was cycling home Friday afternoon. It has been a long week, there was a lady coming up, just tipping my shoulder, telling me, wow, what a beautiful red shoes you're having. And in a way I thought, well, if we were sitting in a car, she would not have stopped knocking at the window because she couldn't see my shoes, but she wouldn't have done it either, because that's not the way that we interact together when we are sitting in our cars. So I think that there is something about experience the city in slow motion, both being on the bikes and being on foot. The next one is a very small story. It's a strategy about how we work with our courtyard gardens, but I think to focusing on having family staying in the city, it is very important that there is some private free space for them, or half private free space for them. This is a program where the state and the municipality pays half-half, so that all the yards within the old part of the city can get some beautiful green yards. What is interesting, talking about also about learning and dialogue and how to get in contact with the citizen, this is based on that there should be some kind of democracy. So they have to do it on their own. They have to organize it themselves. They have to take care of it afterwards. The image before was from my own yard. Doesn't it look nice? Yeah? Yeah? So the story about this is that it's based on democracy. It's based on people taking responsibility themselves. It's paid by both the national money and the municipality money. The next one is, in a way, one would say that this has nothing to do with the architecture. I didn't learn anything about this when I was at the architecture school. But I think it has a lot to do with what kind of cities we are dreaming about. We did this task force group that was across different sectors in the municipality. So there were three different departments having this secretary together. There was one room. Everybody that worked in that secretary could only say yes when people was calling them on the telephone. So they were not allowed to say no. So if there was one person saying, I have this idea making some kind of event in the city, they should start with saying, yes, this is a good idea. And then they should find out all the problems that would be afterwards. But I think this yes culture has actually changing the whole, it's already 5 minutes left, this is hated. But it has changed the culture totally in all the municipality. So when I'm sitting in the office that I'm sitting in, we are still discussing how can we actually be a part of making this project to be better and to happen. So instead of saying no and saying this is not good, we have to go into dialogue together, trying to see if we can reach out something that makes this better. And it's both art projects, it's sports events, it's getting the fashion fair out in the street, out in the urban space, instead of having all the events in all the buildings where people cannot see them. It's also about how to get all the selling out on the street, make it flexible so it can move around where the people are. It's not always something that should be in the building. It's also about how to work with temporary spaces. It's both how to work with the empty buildings, make some short-term rent contract for 2 years, or try to make some urban space. This is a temporary space at Carlsberg. It was one of the most beautiful piece of architecture that I've ever seen. It was 2,500 white robes hanging, waving in the wind, and this orange dot in the middle. Everybody has the feeling of going into that urban space. Everybody has the feeling of being active in all those ropes. I've ever seen so many different kinds of playing kids could do in those ropes. So instead of just having two ropes and you could be swinging, you could make so many different games when you were in them. It's gone now because it was only temporary. So now we are starting to build a school on that side. I know I'm running out of time. I'm tired. No? No? So that was a big scale. The middle scale, focused urban development, This is a very short one. It's just to say that we are trying to put in the investment in focused urban development. We are trying to make some action plans together with the economy department and my apartment. That means that we tell all the private investors where we put all the public investment. And it makes a good security for all the private money, that they know that the bank knows where we will put the public investment. So in a way, that makes a good basic for making a stable economy. It's also a way of saying that we don't want to sprawl out all the urban development at once, but we actually want to start with different parts of the city. Another story about focused urban development is about how to work with neighborhood improvement. Often we only discuss all the new projects. We have an existing part of the city. There is a lot of areas which has a lot of different problems. A lot of criminals or a lot of ethnic people and a lot of people without any work. We go in every year to point out those areas. And what we do is that we put a secretary out on site. So instead of it being planners working in the office, we go out, put a secretary out in the urban space, let those people try to understand what kind of community is in this area. And then there is a bunch of money with this program saying that it should be aware of lifting up the quality of the urban space. And often it actually starts to put a lot of private investment in those areas as well. This is St. Kjeld's. We had a European competition last year, and it ended up with now being the new climate quarter in Copenhagen, because these two young, innovative guys won this competition, and they were starting to say, this is not just about urban space, this is also about climate change. You have to make a totally new area with 20% more green spaces. So we are trying to see if we can implement that. And then the case about how to learn and unlearn is about Ørestad. And I think it will take 5 minutes to... Is it wrong here? Yeah. Has everybody that has been in Copenhagen been in Ørestad?
No.
Then I'll just tell a little about it. Ørestad is, I think, it's one of the last modernistic plans we are having in Copenhagen. It was this area. Here you can see the fortification ring where we was before. This is a listed wild nature, and on the edge of the small housing and the wild nature, we put out a new area in the city. There has been a lot of criticizing about this plan. Some of the good thing about it is that it started with the metro station, and we sold the land to pay for the metro. In the beginning, the metro was an empty train going out there. We were, in a way, we were sometimes joking because we called it the ghost train. But it was actually quite clever to start with the infrastructure. And today the metro is a huge success. It was a competition. It won because of that there was a fantastic water plan. There was four quarters in this area. It was multifunctional with both the housing and both offices. It was fantastic because it was totally connected with nature in a totally new way that we have never seen before, because you have this very urban, very dense city, and then you have this wild, wild nature that will stay on forever, being very wild and very special. So it has a special character in this area. This is the Ørestad North. It's the part of the city that is almost finished. This is one of the beautiful buildings out there. It's Line Tranberg. It's student housing, fantastic project, you should see it. This is the middle of it, the Ørestad City. This is Bjarke Engels designing one of the fantastic housing projects out there. This is Ørestad South, which is one of the areas that we have been building less on yet. This is also Bjarke that have designed the 8th, which is a fantastic housing complex where you have a human scale in a really a big mega structure. This is how it should be, and this is how it looks today. So there is a lot of land still to be out there. There's been a critic because it is a modernistic plan. It's very long lines. It's way too spatial. There is nothing in intimacy, and we did one mistake. We did a big shopping center in the middle of it. We designed the shopping center with one entrance closest to the metro station. Never do that, stupid thing, because then people are not walking in the city. They just walk into the entrance, so they're not giving anything back to the city at all. So because we learned that something went wrong, we started to discuss how can we actually put in a second layer of urban life with all the knowledge that we are having today. This is a temporary space. This is we try to give it some identity about giving a special character about light in the part of the city. We try to focusing on people having the chairs they can move around themselves, trying to see if we could get more people into the city. We were putting shops, trying to put the small shops that were not in the shopping mall, try to put them out on the street on a temporary basis, put them in a container, see if we could get some kind of new life. We did a lot of events. There is now a group organized in that part of the city that is only working with trying to get culture and sport into this area. We made a temporary parkour area, which is the best parkour area in the whole of Copenhagen, which means that it is such a big attractor that all the youngsters from the whole of Copenhagen is now going to this bare field in Ørsted, because this is the only place in Copenhagen where you can do parkour in such a good way. It is a temporary project. It will be there for 5 or 10 years, and then it will be down. Then there was another thing. There is three things that I will show you about how we is learning, unlearning, retrofitting this part of the city. This is a Siugan. It's a very long, narrow, very long, very wide street going across. A lot of wind, no human sense at all. When you are there, you really feel lonely, and you can feel the wind, and you can't get eye contact with anybody. So in a way, this is totally wrong design. We did a lot of temporary projects. We tried to see if we could get another scale in this city. What we also did was we made this competition, very small competition for young architects, seeing if they could try to make a new identity for this street. This group won with those small islands in the city. And what is very interesting is that now you can actually, before you could only go here, falling asleep, sometimes you could cross, go here, falling asleep. Now you can actually cross and make a lot of different nights every night. So in a way, they started to make a new flow. They started to use the water as a place where we can do a lot of things, and they put in some new landscape in this area and a smaller scale. So we are really saying that Ørsted is missing the small scale, and this is about trying to put the small scale into the city. A lot of new urban gardening is starting under this train. The last project that is connected to this story is about the arena area. So we are now in the last part. This is the modernistic plan from before. What we could see about this urban space was that it was the same size as this urban space. And in a way, we think that urban space and green nature is good. But if it is a way too big, it is not that good. So this is the urban city park that we have been building. And there is a lot of people using it, but it will never, ever be a nice space, because it is just a way too big and you can't get eye contact with anybody. So what we thought was that we will not make that same mistake once again. So we tried to see if we could make a new plan. So even though we knew that this is a new plan, we thought that we could make some learning about this plan, and we changed it into a smaller scale where we put the multi-arena in the middle of it, had a lot of dialogue instead of making a normal competition, and we got this wild nature into the space in a smaller sense. And then we put the public building connected to this, and we got a totally new scale in Ørsted, which we were not having before. And then there was this competition about the arena, and I think that is interesting. This is, I think it's Foster and international competition. And what everybody did, except the one project that was winning, and this was the one that was winning, was that they were making this very iconic building, and they were not thinking of urban space at all. Because when you're sitting close to a round circle, you can't see the edge of it, and you just feel that it is way too big, and there isn't any smaller space in that area. The winning team was the 3XN, a Danish office, and they were working with creating smaller spaces all around, smaller spaces all around this big arena, trying to connect the outside and the